press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
This is a News Laundry podcast and you're listening to NL Hafta.
Angrez apna lagan and News Laundry apna hafta kabhi nahi bhoolte. Welcome to episode number 156. Abhinandan's not here. He's... He's whining and dining and having cheese at the Jaipur Lit Fest. So you'll have to
cheese
bear
and wine.
Yeah. So you'll have to bear me as the anchor this week. We have with us a usual Hafta gang, Anand Ranganathan.
Hello.
Our in-house scientist, genius, many things all in one. Anand Vardhan, in-house skeptic, pessimist, and astute columnist. Raman Kirpal, who's managing editor of News Laundry. And we have a very special guest with us, Nitin Gokhale,
who's Hello.
Hi. He's a former journalist. He's worked with Telegraph, NDTV, Sunday Magazine, Tehelka, Outlook. And he's currently a defense and strategic affairs analyst. He's written 6 books. And his latest book, Securing India the Modi Way, is on Pathankot and surgical strikes. There's been a documentary for History, if I'm right.
Yeah, 3 parts documentary.
Yeah, which is... largely inspired by this book. So we'll talk about that. Apart from that, we have a bunch of things to discuss. It's been an action-packed week. The Prime Minister gave 2 interviews, 1 to Z News and the other 2 Times Now. So we'll discuss that if you guys have watched that. He's also in Davos currently, where he delivered a speech. So it'll be nice to know the significance of this trip. The Delhi Election Commission recommended the disqualification of 20 of Aam Aadmi Party's MLAs for holding office for profit. The president accepted the recommendation. The AAP has approached the courts. It's going to file another petition. There was a horrific case of rape and murder reported from Jind of a 15-year-old girl. That case has gotten murkier. The prime suspect in the case was also found dead. The Supreme Court in the Hadia case, I think, gave a welcome order where they said that the National Investigative Agency can investigate all aspects of the case except for the marriage, because that will set a bad precedent. Minister of State Satyapal Singh said that schools should stop teaching Darwin's theory of evolution. I'm sure Anand will have a lot of things to say on that. Kerala was in news for another murder. There was an ABP member, Shyam Prasad, who was hacked to death. The party has accused a PFI member. And Padmaavati is going to release tomorrow. And Karni Sena has unleashed itself upon many cities. There have been buses were tossed in Gurugram. There was Ahmedabad malls were attacked and cars were tossed.
And I just heard that the Haryana government has closed down all pubs and bars.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I know that in Gurugram, they attacked, they pelted stones at a mall and there's
today,
been a lot
they,
of...
Today, in Gujarat also.
Yeah, Ahmedabad also.
They blocked Delhi, Jaipur.
Oh, really?
So we'll get to all of that, but since Nitin is with us, I thought we should start with something that made a lot of news last year, which was surgical strikes.
Last year.
Oh my
2016.
God. It's been long.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So a lot of stuff was said about the surgical strikes. A lot of questions were raised and reports came out that did it happen. There were people who believed ki theek hai ye to hota hi rehta hai, army has always done this, we've always, you know, unke do ye sab chalta rehta hai border pe. But it'll be nice to know from you how was this different from anything that the army had done before when it comes to cross border raids?
Okay, thanks for having me on this thing. I've just answered this in Anand's program. Better people, better informed, better involved people have answered this, but I'll attempt to answer that. As I said before, I've said a number of times that this was an operation that was planned at the highest level, owned by the political leadership and the highest leadership of the army.
Okay.
Elsewhere, when the cross-border raids used to take place, they were at the level of a company or which is 100 people, a major saab or a CO at best, the commanding officer would know about it. And they would do it because their people, 7 of their chaps have been killed, so they will go and kill maybe 14 of their other guys. So it was meant to be, you know, kind of a
one
retribution.
On one. At your own level, you settle scores.
At your level, yeah, settling scores there. This was on a much larger scale, 7 targets chosen across an arc of about 250-300 kilometers, simultaneous attacks on those targets, and again planned at various levels, at the highest level, in fact, at the Prime Minister's level, the clearance was given. So therefore, it was a much different operation than the previous operations. It was meant to convey two or three different messages, which was done, that you told Pakistan that if you come this side and hit our people, we can also go, which we haven't done so far. The hesitation in the previous regimes, including if people are looking for equivalence, including the Vajpayee regime of the NDA, there was always a hesitation of the political leadership to cross the line. You will remember in Kargil, the Vajpayee government prevented the military from crossing the line of control. It was prudent to go and cross the line of control. So that must not be forgotten. So this was a huge political risk and a huge gamble. Anything could have gone wrong, and it would have meant loss of face, loss of political capital to Prime Minister Modi, and the military leadership, of course, would have come under tremendous criticism. So it was, in all senses, a very risky kind of a gamble, which they went ahead and did. So that's why it's different than the earlier operations.
Do you watch a lot of TV news, Nitin?
I don't do it anymore. In fact, you'd be surprised. Even 2 years before I left NDTV, in 2014, November 2014, I had stopped watching primetime news, because I thought they were not primetime news, it was primetime views. And I didn't want people to impose their views on me, and I didn't want the cacophony of trivia, as I call it, to be imposed on me. So I would rather watch movies, read. And I did that from 2012. I distinctly remember that in our house, news television was not part of the viewing, from then. So I don't watch. Even today, I don't watch.
I'm asking because you're a defense analyst, and defense, army, Pakistan, national honor, these things are constant fodder for prime time. Do you watch any of these, like the war studios, the General Sawant, and Major Kamal dressing
up? No, I don't at all.
No.
I get to know about them from Anand Sweets, about the discussions.
There's a new general in town, General Sushant Sarin.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, of course. Oh.
Yes, and his colorful language, which I come to know from Anand. So I actually don't watch.
What made you quit the world of journalism? Is it because of...
Yes and no, both. In fact, I had been there, done that, and I had done 23 years of the 34 years that I have been in journalism that I did in Northeast. So
okay.
I had seen insurgency from close quarters. I had brushed with danger a couple of times, very close and very dangerous things in Northeast. Lived there, reported from there, despite being an outsider. So for me, this was not a challenge when I came to NDTV. When I was invited to join NDTV in 2006 as their defense editor, it was a kind of a reinvention for myself. I did it for a while. I enjoyed it, to be very fair. They gave me a higher profile than I had. But it was getting too trivial for my taste. What I came to realize in television by that time was that television did not value expertise. It needed, and sorry to be using a sexist term, pretty young things to stand in front of the camera for 2 minutes, speak in good English, faff if need be. And
pretty young things can be men as well. So
men, yeah, exactly. But people can misconstrue it. Knowing today's situation, I thought I better clarify. So I did not want to be part of that. It came to a situation where I would be required to give comment on some incident, some ambush.
So it was just opinionating.
Yeah. So
but there's one incident from NDTV which I'd like to speak about. I don't know if you would, but this really came in news. You had interviewed the former Navy Chief Admiral D.K. Joshi.
Yeah.
That interview was pulled down, and it was very critical of the UPA, but it was also critical of a journalist.
Yes, was.
Of who came up with the so-called coup theory. And at that time...
The paper that invented the coup theory was the sentence that he used.
Which was Indian Express. Yeah. But I know this because I had reported on the story.
You had asked me a question also. I remember
but
that.
But we never really got to know. NDTV said that there's some potential defamatory things that we are sorting out, but the interview never came out. So what really happened?
Yes,
why was that pulled down?
It was a last straw on the camel's back, in a sense, for me. When that interview happened, it was... regarded as a big scoop.
Yeah.
And it was a worldwide scoop.
It was with the former Navy Chief, Admiral D.K. Joshi.
Admiral D.K. Joshi, who had resigned in the wake of the submarine accident, second submarine accident.
Yeah.
And it took him 6 months to come on record. And the earlier interview, as he was serving chief, was only to me on television. Hmm. And this was also again to me. So he was very clear when he resigned, the day he resigned, when I spoke to him. He said, if I ever give an interview, I'll give it to only you. Hmm. So I was grateful for that, you know, kind of trust that he had. So I went and interviewed him in Ranikhet, and it was played. In NDTV.
It came on primetime also. Especially the bits about UPA where he criticizes the minister.
It played for 48 hours on both Hindi and English.
So why was it pulled
down? And then suddenly the top bosses in NDTV decided that this was defamatory. And it was, I was told that you did not contest his statements. Mm. So I said there was nothing to contest because what he was saying, I believed in what he was saying. Mm. And in fact, I had, News Laundry had interviewed me, Madhu had interviewed me following that coup story in
2012.
What was it called? Can You Take It or something?
Mm. Yeah, Can You Take It?
Can You Take It? Nitin Gokhale, she had interviewed me. And I was very clear that while the freedom of press is important, I thought that that story actually turned Indians against Indian soldiers. They started suspecting Indian soldiers of disloyalty and so on. I have written about it, I have spoken about it, so nothing hidden about it. So when they said this, they said, we are removing the interview. We are not happy with it. It's got defamatory content. I said, you are welcome to do it because you are the owners, you are the...
By that time, Nitin, I think the interview had already gone viral.
People had
actually made clips of it.
Clips of it, yes.
And even if they removed it, it was actually on the...
It was there. And I think I remember Manisha asking me this question, so I directed you to, I think, Sonia Singh and Barkha.
Who said it was defamatory.
It was defamatory and all that. So
that
it was removed.
That is also the thing with a lot of people who don't realize it. Once you pull something down, it just gets
it
a life
viral,
of its own.
Yeah. It would have just done its own rounds and then gone into...
But now people still talk
still
about it and remember it because it was pulled
down. Then I thought that, you know, it's if they don't trust me and if they think that I did not contest, and I suspect they got hyper, the NDTV management, they got hyper because friends would have called them and said that, why are you... You know, allowing this to go. So I said, you know, there's no point. I'd done enough. As I said, by that 2012, 2011, I was already thinking of, you know, doing something. I needed a trigger. If I look back and see it, I got that trigger. And I said, thank you very much for the good time that I had. And actually, NDTV gave me a much higher profile. I'm grateful for that. There's no denying that fact. But there was time to move on. I had already done it's an 8-year itch that I have in my career. I've always reinvented myself every 7-8 years either by accident, either by design, or by design. And this is what happened. So there I am.
Well, you were in Northeast.
I was, yes.
Can you put some light on the attacks on journalists? So recently there was a report of 40 journalists being in Assam. They have been...
Well, yes.
There's also been in Meghalaya, one of the journalists was attacked by the timber mafia yesterday.
Actually, it's nothing different from what we have in rest of India. Northeast, the dangers were certainly there in the 90s when the insurgencies were raging everywhere. They were at their peak. And we had our challenges, certainly. And what happens is local journalists, as you know, everywhere working for smaller newspapers, smaller channels, are really defenseless. Even if they're intrepid, if they're bold, nobody holds their hands. And so there were people who got killed. I mean, there was Parag Das, very famous journalist, editor of Pratidin newspaper in Assam. There was Kamla Saikia, was the first victim, perhaps, of all that. I remember all that. But as I said, the circumstances are such that you never know who's the target. I have walked the fine line, 23 years. A Gokhale in Northeast is something when I look back, a lot of people say you were brave and all that. I don't think I was brave. I was pragmatic. I was sincere. I learned the language. I was in the society. But certainly we journalists are targets in those places because there are multiple interests that you are actually hitting at. Even Sanjay Ghosh was killed in Majuli because he took on the Ulfa, the mafia there. You know, Sanjay Ghosh, who was an NGO worker, headed the NGO. But I think that is, I don't know whether it has come down. It will be wrong on me, my part, to say that it's come down, the incidences. But if you're saying that somebody in Meghalaya was killed.
But it's true for many parts
of this country.
A lot of the small stringers, reporters.
Exactly.
And it's usually the mafia, the timber,
the
sand mining mafia.
Defenseless people.
Okay, let's get on with the news. Anand, why don't we start with you? Anand Vardhan, what do you want to discuss? Do you want to discuss the PM's interviews? Do you want to discuss his visit to Davos, his speech? Or something else? Tell us.
Interviews, okay.
Interview, okay. So you watched the Zee News?
No, I didn't watch, but you can discuss it.
You didn't watch. Okay. So, Modi, how many of you watched the interviews? Did you
watch? I watched
it?
In parts.
Same here.
I didn't watch at all.
You didn't? Achha, you don't. We've established you don't watch. So, Narendra Modi gave interviews.
I watched the
Times Now.
The Zee one, not the Times
okay.
Now one.
So
the Times Now one was the next day.
Yeah.
And I watched the clip that they gave on Twitter, Times Now. I mean, it's the same thing, boss. So
just for the context, Modi gave two interviews, one to Sudhir Chaudhary of Zee News and the other to Rahul Shivshankar and Navika of Times Now. So Anand, what you saw the Sudhir Chaudhary interview, what did you think of it?
Yeah, well, I mean, it was...
What would you have asked Modi
if you were
instead of Sudhir Chaudhary?
was it the world exclusive interview?
It was a Daily Times kind of interview. You know, I mean, I personally don't find anything wrong with such interviews. But you have to, pigeonhole them as they're not news interviews. They're not there to grill you. It was basically, and I'm sure it was scripted, although Sudhir Chaudhary did not mention it. But even if it wasn't, there was not one tough question. There was not one question on the last 4 years on so many issues, that you could actually corner the Prime Minister on. And you could see from the body language of Narendra Modi as well. It was like, and his language, he was so calm.
Yeah.
He was so unnerved. And he would, whenever he's like that, he puts G at the end, Hum toh aise karne aaye ji. Hum toh ji, dekho ji, aisa hai ji wo.
And for Z,
like your neighborhood aunties.
Z cornering Modi, getting Modi on this platform was a very big thing for them. So
I don't think it was a big thing. I think the Z chairman is the
his book
BJP.
Was inaugurated.
No, but isn't he a Rajya Sabha MP?
Yeah, he's a Rajya Sabha MP.
But he's an independent.
He's an independent, okay.
But he's known to be close to Modi. His book was launched at the Prime Minister's house. I think for me...
So it was like, when you're waiting for your dentist... You get these, housekeeping magazines, and that's the time when I read Filmfare and this.
How about
so that was the time when I could have, if I was waiting for the dentist, I could have watched this interview and enjoyed it.
How would you, Anand, that his comment on pakoras, if you. You saw that part?
Basically, Sudhir asked him ki employment ka kya ho raha hai.
I read the transcript of Times Now interview. Times of India published it.
You read the transcript. You didn't watch it.
No. This was Z where he said, he was talking
about... I also read it somewhere that pakoda, 200 rupees the pakoda wala.
That's doing very fine on Twitter.
So what was that? Sorry, I missed that.
Basically, he asked Narendra Modi about employment. Ki employment generation ke baare mein apne baat kar rahe hai, to kya ho raha hai? To he said ki Z News ke bahar agar koi pakoda beche, to wo bhi to employment hai.
200 rupees.
But that doesn't get counted because it's unorganized sector. But it was just, of course, the kind of employment people are talking about is not
the
pakoda and all that.
Is not,
That got a lot of flack. But I think my favorite question was Sudhir Chaudhary towards the end goes, आप इतने बड़े घर में अकेले कैसे रहते हैं? कभी-कभी मैं सोचता हूँ कि आप फिर कोई philosophical thought नहीं आता आपके दिमाग में?
No, and his answer है देखो जी मैं तो एक कमरे में रहता हूँ
एक ही कमरे में रहता हूँ
जी ऐसा है जी simple है जी
but yeah Modi of course comes out looking really nice in that interview.
Now one remembers in early 90s Mrinal Pandey when she was with Durdarshan for a very short stint she interviewed P.V. Narasimha Rao. And some of the questions were similar. do you get time to read now? I think it's on YouTube also, that interview. I think soft questions to public leaders are not something to laugh off because people want to know these aspects of public leaders. So soft interviews are also welcome. But the thing and all the pakora thing, I think he has this habit of using common parlance to strike a chord with the people. And the point he was making, he may not be very articulate in economic sense, and he doesn't claim to be, but it was that informal sector jobs are also jobs. If an office is set up and someone is doing something tangential to it, it is also a sort of employment, though that's not a question, and that's not an answer one expects from the executive head of a state, but okay, means...
the problem is there was nothing hard about the interview. It was soft throughout. And somebody who has not has not been holding press conference, for the past 3-4 years and giving selective interviews to someone. So someone expects, there was no question on demonetization. There was no question on GST. There was no question on
demonetization and GST.
There was no question on Kashmir. So you expect at least some depth.
Some policy articulation, perhaps. I haven't seen it, but was there any policy articulation?
Well, I mean, he asked questions on GST, on demonetization, but the answers were too vague, and his questions were also not pointed. It was very like...
What do you think of demonetization?
Also, he'd say if you're talking about economic growth, he said things like, ab aapke prime minister banne se sab GDP ke baare mein baat karne lage hain. Nation has suddenly started talking about GDP, toh ye change kaise aaya? Ya aap itte bade logon se dosti karte ho? Like on foreign relations is, they weren't like pointed questions that you'd expect. But anyway, that was Sudhir Chaudhary. We don't expect much from him.
And two disappointing aspects of his evolution of Hindi. One is this ending with G, and which is a kind of Punjabi kind of Hindi, a kind of corruption that has...
That is true, yeah.
A kind of corruption that has sipped into with his stay in Delhi, perhaps. Mm. So, and second...
Corruption is language, you mean.
yeah. And second is, now the...
Actually, that's true. You see, Arvind Kejriwal talks a lot like that. Yeah. Like, hum to aise hai
ji.
He puts a G...
For proper Hindi speaking states, that's quite irritating. And second is the progressive deterioration would be that aap would be followed by kada hai, aapne kada hai, aapne kiya hai. Now the Delhite Hindi is like aapne ye kada hai. Now he may now end up like that also. Means there is a progressive deterioration.
No, I didn't get this. What did you say? Means like he
means aap has to be followed by a verb that is equivalent to aap. That aap paisa kijiye.
But you can't beat Rahul Shivshankar, who started his interview saying so much kiya hai. So much hua. He said, Modi ji, so much hua hai. Itna kiya hai. Aage kya? I was like, wow.
Well, but that's also the English.
That's also because in English, these anchors aren't comfortable speaking English.
So Sudhir was saying that, sir, aapne toh bahut kuch kiya hai. Lekin aapke ministers, baaki logo ne itna kaam nahi kiya. Toh itna woh drop karta tha, woh itna bol ke chup ho gaya tha.
But the refreshing thing, if I may say so, in the Sudhir Chaudhary one that I watched, that Modi did not talk in third person. Many times, dekho Modi maharajaon ki tarah, ki ab Modi ye kar chuke hain, ab
Modi ek masala hai.
Modi,
What about the trip to Davos? A lot has been made of it. It's been dominating the prime time news. Is it a big deal? Is it not? Did you guys watch his speech?
I missed his speech, but I saw the Twitter memes that started.
Oh, him waiting at the bus stop.
Bus stop, and then what was that television serial? I forgot. The TV show, The Winter's Coming. Good Lord.
Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones, yeah. So it's snowing. This Davos thing I've never understood. I think it is basically not to... It doesn't give anything tangible. It's a networking, the whole, it's like a huge tent. It's like a marriage ceremony in Delhi. Mm. And you have this tent and you basically pack 200 people in it. And sare barati hain, sab khana wana kha rahe hain, sab, khana khana khate pe, they're just talking, ki are bhai, this is my visitor's card. It's, to someone who's not in that domain of networking or on this business and CEO, this thing, it can be awfully boring. There's nothing new that would come out.
No. This, to me, I mean, I think his speech in Hindi to international community and live telecast here is a political message to
It was
people.
Both supposed to be a message from what I read in the papers was well, to the domestic audience as well as the international audience. And I think because India's flavor of the season, they got Modi to speak in the plenary. I believe that's a big deal.
That is
deal.
What was
That
the
is
big,
a big
yeah.
deal as far as
the he's the first Indian Prime Minister to
after
have.
After 20 years, I think. No? Or in the plenary,
years.
I don't know. But he was the first Prime Minister to go to Davos after 20 years, after Devegowda, is what the papers say. So,
that's true.
1997. But that time, Devegowda was ignored, I believe, in that entire thing. So, you don't expect Devegowda to set Davos on fire.
Anand, your view on Davos, no, big deal?
Davos is what to see, presentations that people make for potential investors. So national governments make their pitch for potential investors. So Davos is that kind of event. It's a kind of JLF for prospective writers.
Very contemporary.
For a third world country, it would be very irrelevant. But for a country of India's size and economic potential, like and the possibilities, I think that kind of networking comes with the package. There are things that you have to do to remain relevant on in a globalized world. But Prime Minister lamented the decline of globalization there also.
Yes,
protectionism. Yeah, he says. I read in the papers again that
protectionist. Yes. So it was President Trump is going to speak last. So some paper interpreted it as an anti-Trump slant in the inaugural address only. So,
Raman sir, your view? What was?
No, I said.
Key for?
I said. I mean, to me,
have you been to Davos?
No.
There is at least one place where.
It's also
Raman
a great time for journalists. I believe it's a junket.
Twitter page journalists
free?
Are so super excited.
Yeah. Yes.
Rahul Kamal.
I don't know whether the government has taken them.
No, the government doesn't.
So the organization pays for it.
Looks like
that's a lot of money.
Or the phone. Even digital entities like print
is there.
Shekhar Gupta. Scroll in Davos.
Not even till Jaipur.
This is where the right time for you to pitch about subscription.
Yeah.
So that you can go to Davos.
So that you can send us to Davos.
Yeah. If Abhinandan hota to ye zarur kehta. Bahut khoro.
Yes. Please do the needful. Okay. On that note, I'm going to read a letter from a subscriber by Juzer Ali. He says, I'm a subscriber. Thanks for producing NL Hafta, NL Charcha. Me and my wife are regular listeners. I used to believe that in this age of information, quality content would be freely available. But I do realize now that there's no such thing as free lunch. I want to contribute the following opinion about the great hypocrisy of our time. So he's talking about Satyapal Singh's comment, actually, about Darwinian evolutionary theory. Clearly, the MP has no knowledge of evolutionary theory, but his statement betrays a larger hypocrisy in our culture which needs to be addressed. This is not the first time a position of authority has challenged prevalent scientific opinion, which is based on overwhelming evidence with nothing but superficial statements. This isn't just a problem with politicians. Darwinian evolution is even more so a matter of contention among religious groups, as it doesn't fit most religious narratives about origin of man. Abrahamic religions believe Adam was sent from heaven, while Hindu theology states that men were created from different body parts of Purusha. Evolutionary theory is a tough challenge for religious traditions which insists on nobility of man. Be it the honored MP, head of religious groups, I'm sure they won't hesitate before taking antibiotics when prescribed by a doctor practicing allopathy, or they will readily have a doctor treat them for cancer. But evolutionary theory is the basis of modern medicine. To deny evolution, as Sal Khan from Khan Academy puts it, is to deny modern medicine. And then he writes about case against Ayurveda. Ayurveda may have been a thriving science at one point, but seems like the tradition wasn't carried forward by many pupils. Stop discovering and innovating. And now it's as good as a dodo. Well, I don't agree with that. I mean, I do think Ayurveda still has its position. But it's true that a lot of... there aren't the sort of practitioners who can take the discipline ahead. We should really think about it. So, Anand, what do you make of the minister saying ki aapne kabhi bandar ko insaan bante hue dekha?
I think insaan ko bandar bante hue to us din dekh liya humne. But I mean, to be honest, what can one say? You know, it's like anjaame gulistan kya hoga, har shaakh pe ullu baitha hai. But it's not so much as his denying Darwinian evolution. I mean, millions do. In fact, if you believe in God, you know, in Islam, in Christianity, in some, you know, philosophical treatises of Hinduism, like he mentioned, you know, but Hinduism is so diverse that, you know, you're not prescribed to follow a book. So, you know, hardly somebody would believe in it. Most of people wouldn't believe in it. Then there is the other contention that Dashavatar is actually a kind of, you know, it alludes to Darwinian evolution. There
really?
Could be some truth to it, you know, from fish to tortoise and then to, you know, basically all the 10 avatars. It's a very light illusion, if I can call it that. But you see, my problem is not that, again, you know, that he denied Darwinian evolution. My problem is that he's saying that one should stop teaching it. Now, that's the problem. That's
and
the
also
worry.
I think he's followed up with something that we're going to hold a seminar or
hold
a conference.
Hold a conference.
International seminar.
Yeah, and today, thankfully, I don't know, Baba.
But Javadekar said there's no need to hold a conference.
Yeah. Although Javadekar hasn't himself said whether he believes in Darwinian evolution or not. Probably doesn't. But you see, the one contention is that people call it theory of evolution. Now, when of course, when it was proposed by Darwin, in fact, Wallace proposed it before Darwin. And then Huxley was the one who 8 years before The Descent of Man actually said that man evolved from apes. And then Darwin wrote that book, Descent of Man, and things of that sort. So for 70, 80, 90 years, you know, people believed it as theory. And a lot of, in fact, all God-fearing religions and Abrahamic, as he calls it, this gentleman, did not believe in Darwinian theory of evolution. But right now, it is not a theory. It is an axiom. So there are four concrete landmark things and experiments and events that have happened in molecular biology that have proven beyond doubt Darwinian evolution. So it should not be called a theory of evolution. It is an axiom. It is not even a law. It is something that becomes an axiom, like 2 plus 2 equals 4. And the first one is, of course, genome sequencing. You know, when you sequence the genomes of all organisms, and thousands of different organisms have been sequenced, including humans, chimpanzees, you find that most of the housekeeping genes, by housekeeping I mean that the absolutely essential genes that make the cell function, that make proteins, that create more DNA, polymerize DNA, and make RNA, make so many other things that are important for the sustenance of the cell, they all share a common origin, right from a tiniest of bacteria to a whale or an elephant or a human being. And chimpanzee DNA is 98.4% identical to the human, not just similar, it's 98.4% identical. So it's been
proven. So chimpanzee you nahi dikh raha hame aadmi mein badalte hue.
Yes, I mean, to come back to that, you see, it is not an overnight transformation. Evolution is, and you know, in fact, I wouldn't so much as blame this.
I think that's true, you know, like it's a very, I mean.
I was just going to say that perhaps he stopped reading and learning about the theory and thought it's just a theory.
It's just
without knowing all
so
this.
That's the problem.
And that's where I think he should not get into an area which is, he does not have an expertise.
And as he said, 100 years of
100
research.
Years, it was theory. I mean, in fact, you know, The Descent of Man, you know, was so much protested against by the Christians, you know, at that point it came in 1890s, 1870s.
Yeah,
it was unbelievable.
Also, which is very...
And so the first one was genome sequencing. The second one is directed evolution, sexual PCR by William Stemmer. I mean, after PCR and the discovery of the double helical structure of DNA, I think the most significant experiment done in molecular biology, where he showed that within half an hour, you can accumulate enough mutations in the gene, you can force mutations, evidence, so the gene, the cell that carries that gene can survive. There is direct evidence of evolution. The third is ribozyme, discovery of ribozyme, which is that RNA can actually act as proteins, right? So, you know, that is, and the fourth is protocell. Protocell is by Zostak, another Nobel laureate, that shows that even if you do not have the replicating machinery in the cell, the most primitive cell, protocell, with just some fatty acids and, you know, cells thing, can actually adapt to a Darwinian evolution. So with no machinery inside to replicate the cell, just the osmotic pressure of the cell and the RNA content inside can actually force the cell to divide. And then from there, RNA world, we've come to humans. So please don't call it a theory anymore. In fact, a lot of people still call it theory, which is fine. You know, one is, I'm ambivalent to people not believing in science. That's fine. But problem is when you stop people from, now even I'll exceed, you can also say, you know, in school books that theory of evolution is wrong. So many people believe it. Whoa. But at least teach what people believe is right.
And let people let debate people or think debate. About it. Yeah.
You see?
Anand, so, you were about to say something.
Yes, I am not scientifically equipped to comment on that.
No,
but,
not at all.
So, Anand has enriched us.
No. But the terminologies we may not understand. But it has a history of being contested.
Of course.
And newspapers, if you browse internet or newspapers, or there have been instances where it has been questioned within scientific community also. Hmm. There was a 2014 paper in Nature magazine which questioned it. That is all fine, but what he is saying that you cannot, on basis of that, say that it cannot be taught. That is problematic, and he made it worse by that expectation of someone seeing a monkey turning into man. So that's an angry.
I couldn't believe it.
So,
I mean,
see, in cancers,
so,
for
but,
example,
that may be his colorful way of putting it, but. And if you see, he is an MPhil in chemistry.
He was an IPS officer. He was a Mumbai police commissioner. He puts a doctor in front of his name. PhD
he has done when he was in IPS. He has taken a doctorate in public management from a foreign university, but his doctorate is not in chemistry. He's an MPhil in chemistry from Delhi University. So he was an IPS officer. So he knows his science more than an average man.
Definitely. If he's done his MPhil in chemistry.
But of course, I remember that in 2012, he has this right wing shift to his thinking when he was in police. In 2012, in a Mumbai newspaper, perhaps in Indian Express or someone, something like that, he quoted controversy when he went to a convent school and said that students were not dressed properly. So he said that these are one of the disadvantages of attending convent schools. Yes. So while being in police force, he had these kind of statements to make. So he had a history. So that has of course blinded him to scientific rigor or something.
So, you know, again, just to finish up on that, I mean, in Kansas, for example, a lot of Bible Belt. There's for the last 10-15 years this debate between intelligent design, creationism versus Darwinian. So in schools, whether it should be taught or not, in Turkey right now they've actually stopped. Government has asked Darwinian evolution not to be taught. So you know, it's not that he said something which I would say majority of the world doesn't believe in. In fact, I would say he's actually in keeping with the general perception of the world, which is mostly religious. The problem is, again, as I repeat myself,
saying that
which
don't
is,
teach
yeah,
it.
Don't teach
and
it.
And falsification is something very close to science. It means one of the ways of scientific thought is you falsify things. Karl Popper's method that you see 100 crows and all are, you say crows are black till you see the 101st crow which is white. And that theory is replaced by that crows are
but generally
crows
this
are
thing
black
stops
but they can be
after
white
it, the theory becomes an axiom.
Yeah,
like you know, I for example, somebody can say, oh, the B form of DNA is not double helical. Now, obviously, you can say, well, okay, I'm this is my point of view, but after the structure has come out, after the structure has come out, after the last, you know, last 50 years, people have proven it's an axiom that B form of DNA is double helical. For someone to say no, it's not. What can you do about it, you know?
Okay. Who is more stupid? The one who asked the question or the one who shut him up?
Where?
In this, he asked a question, he challenged the theory or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And there is HRD minister who just shut him up. So HRD minister said ki he should
boss
not ask
shut
this
him
question.
Up and
oh,
said
his boss, yeah, okay.
Prakash
yeah.
So Javadekar said...
Who of the two is more stupid?
So the first thing that I've learned is that you can ask the most stupidest of questions. And I'm saying, but you know, I would not call you a stupid because no question is stupid. You know, because
spoken
it
like
always,
a true teacher.
No, it always instills something. It's a devil's advocate thinking, by oh my God, he said this. Now this is, these are my 4 points by which I can disprove him. But again, you know, you can't stop people from not learning something. And I said this 3-4 years ago that, you know, you introduce a lot of quasi-religious texts in schools, right? By quasi-religious, I mean a way of life. You can call it Gita, Mahabharata, and you have Bible, Quran, learn more about it. You should also have books by, for that teach atheism or that talk about, you know, for example, Hitchens or you talk about Dawkins. Why not introduce these books, you know? Let students make their own mind.
Long so, time.
Yeah, but after this, I'm sure it's never going to happen.
Okay, moving on. Raman sir, maybe we should speak about the AAP MLAs who were disqualified. Could you give us a little background on what that was that made a lot of news? A lot of people have called it political vendetta and the EC being used. A lot of people have said that AAP had it coming. So just a little bit of background and then maybe we can ask everyone.
AAP basically what had happened initially, these 20 MLAs were given a post.
Parliamentary secretaries.
And later when somebody challenged it in a court of law, they realized the mistake and they immediately tried to bring in a legislation.
Yeah.
Okay, so they were caught red-handed. Now their defense is, there are 2-3 things in this. The one defense that they give by countering that it happens in Madhya Pradesh also, where the BJP is ruling. Okay, but that counter cannot work. I mean, if you have done something wrong, you cannot say that that person is also doing. So nobody has challenged there. I mean, if they challenge there, I think EC is going to. Second thing is why EC has taken so much time to disqualify there. Because they have done a mistake. AAP has done a mistake. I mean, and this, they need to be disqualified for this. But why EC sat over it for nearly two, three years?
AAP had a problem of plenty, I think. They didn't know how to accommodate so many MLAs. So they did that. So don't blame them, actually.
On a lighter note, yes. So that is there. And the AAP, another question that the AAP is trying to raise that they were not heard on this issue. But the EC, I think, held
a press conference. Today, I think he said something, in the papers I saw that they never came to us for hearing. I think the EC, the outgoing EC or somebody.
They said
we will speak at the appropriate time or something. But they, EC is saying that on their part, they had asked them to clarify their position on this.
They never came. That's what EC is saying.
They never came on this. So, but I think this was destined. I mean, they had to be, as per the law, they had to be shunted out. No doubt about it.
Anand?
I agree with Raman. The whole point is people forget this and, they indulge into whataboutery. But the point is selective application or using the law is not a defense. I mean, you cannot say कि अरे उसको पकड़ लिया, उसको नहीं पकड़ा, मुझे पकड़ लिया. You know, उसको तुमने speeding ticket नहीं दिया, मुझे दे दिया. So, I mean, that theory doesn't stand. In fact, I remember when it came out, they took the example not of Madhya Pradesh but of Gujarat, without realizing that Gujarat guys in 1969, I think the Congress government were very clever. They first passed the bill. And then they allowed the, you know, this...
J.R. Bachchan was disqualified.
Retrospectively.
Yes. And there is no history in the EC of being selective in such issues. So that is why I will not...
Sonia Gandhi.
Ha, Sonia Gandhi also.
That national, the NAC.
Yes.
I think that was...
She had to resign
so,
and she...
So here I will not say that the EC was selective. But yes, why they sat over it for so long?
That's the question, yeah.
Plus, so many conspiracy theories also. Now, see, they're saying that the president is in the pocket of BJP.
I feel, if we outside the preview of this law, I only have one thing to say. See, we, at the end of the day, 20 elections is going to happen in 20 assemblies. And this is our money that they're going to spend. So here, if the allegation, I mean, this secretary, if they had not taken money, if the EC had done some investigations, they could have given, you know, small warning or something. So I think it should have been there. I mean, just thinking that the public money being not wasted.
So this is a very interesting question. Sorry, before this come in, that I had never thought of that. You know, so 20 by-elections are going to take place. And crores of money, taxpayers' money, yes. And time hours, man hours, yes. For, you know, manning, yes. The election, everything's, yes. Open. Who is liable for it? I mean, would the AAP MLAs be prosecutable, liable for this?
No.
If they
it's going to be on government
expenses. They have
expense.
Just been
election commission expenses,
yes.
Which is our money after
which
all.
Which is our money.
What's your view on this, Nitin, the whole AAP controversy?
I agree with Raman on that. And to say that the president is in the pocket of the BJP is unfair because the president cannot go out of the, I mean, away from the advice given by the election commission. He has no separate powers of investigation or separate powers of adjudication. So to blame him is completely unfair. To my mind, AAP can actually turn it into an advantage by playing victim. Which I'm
That's
sure they will do.
Do.
They will do, I suppose, going forward, going by their record. That, you know, it's always that they've whataboutery that Anand mentioned. Here, they'll not do whataboutery, but they will play victim and say that there's a conspiracy theory. And many people, I suspect, voters would tend to believe it.
Mm-hmm. Anand?
Just 2-3 hours ago, Delhi High Court has put a stay on announcement of polls by EC.
By polls.
So, that aside, it is one of the consequences of the 93rd Constitution Amendment, which freezes the number of ministers to 15% of the strength of the assembly. Now, it is overreaching of the accommodation politics where you try to distribute the loaves and fishes of office to people who you couldn't accommodate within ministries.
So basically you appease MLAs by giving them some
that's
posts.
That's the problem of plenty that I was talking about. Mm-hmm. Because if you have 67 MLAs, how do you keep them happy?
Kejriwal said na ki Bhagwan ne humko isiliye 67 seat mein jitaya ki 20 ko jana tha taki hamari government bane.
In fact, before the elections, the Delhi Assembly elections, there was a person I met who was working with the IT cell of AAP, and he was very clear that if this time they didn't accommodate me, they don't accommodate me in some position of power, I would leave them. So there were many aspirants like him also. So that is one thing. The where they blundered is that they wanted the bill to work with retrospective effect, which it can't. So
it can't.
It can't. So it cannot work in retrospective way. So that is one thing. Now the conspiracy theory is about. I think BJP, even if it planned this, they would. They are an entity which is likely to get least from it because I think if elections are held. It would dent BJP's political capital in a say in Delhi, where it is possibilities are not as bright as because if in the penultimate year of the general elections, if you lose say 15 seats out of 20, then it somehow devalues your political capital. So I don't think it's a very if it is a BJP move, it's not a very
smart move.
So would you say it would be a test for Modi?
Again, so the problem with Modi is that panchayat elections to every election is a test for Modi. So he
but
has
one thing is certainly suspect. The outgoing CEC is actually, there's a new one's been appointed today. So this guy comes up with this decision a day before he's to retire. That is a bit odd to me. I mean, you know,
there are bureaucrats who even Supreme Court judges who wait for last day to do very important things.
Yes,
it has it has been history of constitutional offices in India. And also
Justice Shah, I think the 377.
And also you see, if AAP takes this case to it has already to Delhi High Court and Supreme Court, the history has been that courts generally don't have much sway over constitutional bodies like UPSC, Election Commission.
Judicial body.
Election Commission. Courts are not very effective vis-a-vis these bodies. The only instance where it has been very effective, and that was Ishi's own problem in mid-90s when those the three election commissioners were fighting for their own turf that all should have equal powers, and there's the session time Krishnamurti and this. So that is, so they are it is less likely that they will get a reprieve from the court.
Okay, I'm going to read out another letter before we get to the next topic. This one is from Saurabh. He had written to us last week, actually, also on the Quint, you know, story that we had discussed. So he says, this email goes specifically to you, Abhinandan, because of your strong views on the subject of journalistic duty. Thank you for sparing a significant amount of time on my email. I wrote to you in my capacity as a regular average subscriber, and the rank in my email was just a default footer. I didn't intend to use my rank position to prove my point. So maybe next time you can just address me as Saurabh. You know, he had basically, we had discussed at length the Quint story that was pulled down.
Chandan Nandi's story
which basically said that Kulbhushan Jadhav was a spy. We discussed, Abhinandan was of the view that journalists can't care about national interest when, you know, if you have...
If the story is right,
it's credible, it has a meaning.
If the story is right. So there I have this, I mean, I don't know what you've discussed, but I don't mind that kind of a story, and it should be done. We have, I mean, many people have done this kind of a story. One has done that. But then the editorial leadership must then stand by that story.
That was a very weak story.
But there is a, I think, I don't know who, you wrote or somebody else that he has a record of doing...
That was Shivam's, which...
Even the surgical strikes, which I have detailed in so many things, I remember it was done about 7 days in advance.
Chandan Nandi had done a story
exactly
on,
and said had, that, you know, this had happened.
He had preempted the
surgical
strikes.
He had preempted
strikes.
The whole thing when nothing had happened. I mean, actually, I don't know whether he was set up or he was given some information, because actually there were two surveillance reconnaissance teams which had gone to survey the targets, and they had stayed inside Pakistan-occupied Kashmir for 24 hours on in two different axes. And that was more dangerous than the actual strike, because the actual strike they only did for 15-20 minutes and came away. So maybe somebody told him that, and then sort of he just let it loose, you know, let the entire story. So there is this thing. So I would say if the story was right, I'm all for it. The editorial leadership then should have just
stood
by the story. It doesn't happen. I've had occasions after Kargil where Vinod Mehta had withstood pressure from Vajpayee. I was witness to it, that the Prime Minister is calling Vinod Mehta and saying, Mehta ji, kya kar rahe ho, aage election hai, ye mat kariye. You know, we had done some critical story of the Vajpayee government on the Kargil issue. So Vinod Mehta, the finest editor that I've worked with, he said, आप एक चिट्ठी लिख दीजिए हम अगले इशू में छाप देंगे उसको. So you have to have those kind of guts.
Finest.
You have to stand by the story. The story also has to be worth you know, being
but
standing.
One question to Nitin on the same subject. You wouldn't be worried that printing of this, publishing of this story, even if the editor stands by it, would put the spy or non-spy's life in danger?
Yeah, I would be worried. I would be worried. And therefore, the discretion that I spoke about, which I was advised, you know, as a young 22-year-old reporter, cub reporter by M.V. Kamath, it is more important what you don't write than what you write. What he meant was that you have to be discreet. You have to choose the timing. This could have been, this story could have been written
if
maybe,
he was,
you know, if
back.
He has come back.
You or have a temptation. I tell you, I mean, I give you one example. Again, Vinod Mehta. I had somebody as director of, you know, DRDO. So I, at that time, there was some nuclear leakage in Brazil or something, and we were importing sugar from Brazil. So I bought 2 kg of sugar from Super. That time we used to have Supermarket in CP, in Connaught Place. So from there I bought, and then I gave that sugar for the you know, test. My uncle, he did it at DRDO.
Okay.
And he found the traces of radiation.
My God.
And he gave me the entire report. And I...
The sugar was bought from Brazil.
At that time, we used to have no telephones, nothing. So I just gave it to my chief reporter. Boss, I've got this story. And I just went out for another story. And they were searching for me all over, Sheikh, this Vinod Mehta. And they called me I think 4 or 5 o'clock, they told me that they are looking for you. So I went. So there was a
huddle editors.
Of all the editors. All the editors were there. And they had a meeting, and Vinod Mehta was so tempted. And then you had Ajoy Bose.
That's right.
You had this.
This is in Sunday.
But then the story didn't go?
No, he said, no, let us go. Let us go with the story. So Ajay boss, even I was telling him, boss, this is my uncle who has done it. and we have nothing on paper. We have nothing. I was also tempted. I mean, as a reporter, I was. Because he was telling me what is going to happen to pregnant women. It was I told Vinod Mehta, ki, why don't we get it independently done? Now, at those days, independently done means you have to send these samples to the US. Okay, so we didn't have that kind of money. So we couldn't send it to, and then the better sense prevailed. The story never went.
There was no proof really in that.
But then that's also a huge story to do. I mean, it should have been done though. Because
my God,
it was a huge story. No, but I tell you what happened. No, okay, I tell you the second thing. I said, okay, Vinod Mehta was so insistent. He wanted this story to go. I said, okay, let me get it. Double check. So I again went to my uncle. Then he understood the journalistic implications. So he was very afraid. So he told me, this is the second thing he said, ki Raman, the first time the test tube was contaminated, the second time the test tube wasn't. So he said, ki no, I think there are no traces. Second time when he did it. So anyway, I wasn't into, as a reporter, we have been told that you have to double check your facts. So in this particular story,
that's
of
right.
Chandan's landing,
yes.
I mean, there was nothing. The two sources saying that he's a spy. How can you?
No, no, but I'll tell you another Vinod Mehta story if you have time. because during Kargil,
okay.
In the
last
first week of my reporting there, I went there and I learned that there were huge bungles and this war should not have happened. Young officers were telling me, Jawans were telling me. So I came back to Delhi on a weekend in between the war. I think Outlook Money was being launched. Sandeepan Dev was the editor and all that. So I came for that. And I went and whispered into Vinod's ear that this has happened. He said, look, just concentrate on your reporting right now. Let the war get over. This is not the time to do the contrarian story. We will do it after that. And actually, the stories that we did post-war was follow-up of that. He actually reminded me. I was going back to Guwahati after 45 days. He said, what about that story that you mentioned? Please follow up. So discretion,
so
timing is extremely
important.
Yeah. And exactly, timing, I think, is very important in this case. Anyway, just getting quickly finishing off this letter. He says that while on the topic of duty, there's a subtle difference between duty towards nation and towards government. That's the difference between his team between the work done by you and your team versus work done by Argo and his team. So ultimate question is a philosophical one. What is your definition of duty? A corollary is whose duty are you doing and whether your duty clashes with mine. Basically, we had also, you know, Anand Vardhan had given us an example of what if a sports person who's won a gold medal gets caught doping? Do you expose him or not? So he's referring to that. Next. What do we go with next? What?
I think the duty of a reporter is, I mean, he has no religion.
To do the story. And let the decision be taken by the leadership.
Yes.
So, okay, moving on. Padmaavati released today, Padmaavati in 3D. I don't know who will watch Padmaavati in 3D. Those who want to watch Deepika closely, I guess, or Ranveer Singh closely. So anyway, it's released today and it gets a nationwide release tomorrow. And Karni Sena has really been let loose. Buses have been burnt. They've absolutely gone on a rampage. For some strange reason, Karni Sena representatives on primetime TV come wearing a beret. I don't know why. But anyway, so they're all over primetime and malls. I saw some really horrible images of malls being pelted and window panes being broken. I really don't know how. It is a fringe group, I'm guessing. I do think it's a fringe group. It's not really mainstream. It has been mainstream, I think, because of television coverage.
It's becoming a monster.
Yeah. I don't know how you can get away with that. Despite a Supreme Court order, despite your government...
They're getting away for very simple reasons. For inertia on the part of the politicians, whether opposition, politicians in the opposition or politicians in power.
Who are ruling, yeah.
Yes. Because even the Congress doesn't want to... What is Congress doing on this front? They're not speaking much about it because they will lose their votes. Mm. So I think it's a complete political inertia which has led to this.
Mm. But somewhere it has to stop, no?
I mean, it has to stop.
It has to stop somewhere.
And as we are speaking, I'm seeing this this really scary image of children in a school bus in Gurgaon crouching and terrified, and you have Karni Sena goons pelting stones. I don't even know if these are... I wonder if these are even people who know what they're doing. It could very well be just goons bought to just go crazy before the release, because it's really tough for me to believe also that in a place like Gurgaon there would be... you could rally a mob for Padmaavati, you know, some princess of Rajasthan.
None of them have seen the movie.
Yeah, of course, but that's never really important. Whether you want to see
the passions can be whipped up. I mean, it's a simple thing about so-called honor and prestige and whatever.
But what's
let me choose my words very carefully and say that this is an example of a failed state. You can look at it from any angle, and the only conclusion is that we are a conglomeration of failed states. And I disagree with Raman there when he says that even the opposition is to blame. See, the opposition is not in power. The people who are in power, the people who have law and order under their control, the people who've been ordered by the Supreme Court to make sure none of this happens, they are allowing this to happen.
Right.
So opposition kahan aa gaya
beech mein? Opposition ke liye is a very good rallying point to prove that they also matter.
Yeah.
So in your life, in your political life, you get very few such rallying points. Mm. So I think in this particular case, the opposition
but I'm
completely
talking of action on these goons. You know, the action cannot be opposition.
No, definitely not.
Action
but the opposition can be a pressure group to ensure that the state works. So they are not even acting as pressure groups.
But
so
it's sad. What I agree with Anand, what he's saying is that if the people who are supposed to protect lives and property are failing to do their duty, then they don't deserve to be where they are.
Yeah. Mm. You know, it's...
That is definitely there. But I personally feel that there is a complete political inertia. Because, see, that state alone... If you leave everything, to state alone, things will not move. So you need pressure groups to, put that kind of pressure.
No, but see, again, when you're talking of pressure, again, apologies, but it's like a little bit, you see. Uh-huh. None of the people who are in power, they have the law and order with them, are acting. That's not all. None of the BJP politicians have called these guys goons and we'll set you right.
Absolutely.
No comment from the Prime Minister, no comment from Amit Shah. So it is a failed state in that sense.
Absolutely.
You see?
I'm here with you.
Yeah.
I'm here with you, but I'm taking it a little further.
Mm.
That there is a failure on the part of the opposition too.
To rake it up and
yes.
Make a big deal about it. Anand, Vardhan?
Yes, of course, failed state means one of the elementary descriptions of a state is that it has coercive power over violence. Means it has monopolistic control over violence. So the production of violence has to be a state monopoly. So, as I have earlier also pointed out, that a state has to act as the biggest thug when there are other thuggery in the its territory, in its territory. So it has to act as the biggest thug. And two things are clear, that there is an outsourcing of lumpenization, because the Karnishena is not a kind of group which has a cadre which can be mobilized overnight to do violent act.
Yeah, in fact, before Padmavati, one never even heard of Karnisena.
So it's an ad hoc kind of organization, which is at best functional in annual sammelans and speech giving. So how it could galvanize it? So it's an outsourcing of lumpenization to one extent. Now, the question is not about freedom of speech or something like that. Those are means anyway very what you can perfunctory things to say, but it's now about law and order. Means the discourse has shifted now, that kind of discourse around freedom of speech is over.
It's you know,
it's it's about all law and order and the inability of it. And you see Hardik Patel and Alpesh Thakur siding with the protesters, and they have they are as against Padmavat as anybody else. Wow. Now, this is the nature of identity politics and communities exerting political sway. So it is it may sound pessimistic, but it is a sign of things that will to come, and it will happen in India for a very long time to come. So it is not something that should surprise anybody.
Yeah, time to time such issues come. It could be Maratha identity politics. Yeah. It could be Bhima Koregaon, it could be, you know, any of the, or some books sometimes.
I still remember, of course, Anand Wood, I think in the 90s, Nayapol wrote A Million Mutinies Now, when he went and talked to Shiv Sena, he talked to a lot of Khalistan, these people. And there seems to be a cycle that India is a cycle, birth of rebirth, you know, keeps on repeating itself. You know, nobody can put a stop to it. And maybe this is the kind of diversity that we people like. I have no idea. You know,
there's going to be no screening of Padmavat in Rajasthan.
Yeah, Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh also.
The Supreme Court has dismissed.
They've dismissed, but the film distributors...
That's the thing. In fact, that is what is going to happen in Gujarat.
Yeah.
So even though Gujarat will not ban it, all the distributors will say we are scared to...
The Supreme Court's power.
Yeah.
Completely.
What can the Supreme Court do?
And it makes, I mean, you can't blame them also. Who wants to take on, I mean, like, if the state
the
can't protect you?
Right
yeah.
now, I mean, school
vandalization
kids and bus,
everywhere. Yeah. Who's going to, you know, sort of look for it?
Okay, that's all we have for this week's Hafta. So yeah, this is going to be free. This podcast is going to be free because it's going to be released on Republic Day. So that's our gift from independent media to our independent listeners. Please keep your suggestions ready. Let's start with Anand. Do you want to give your suggestions?
So I have a couple of suggestions. One is I watched this film, The Post, Spielberg's film.
Oh, true. So did I.
This is
on Saturday. It's
absolutely
amazing.
Fantastic film. Yes. You know,
I think Meryl Streep was just...
It has
just
been nominated
for Oscars, I think, for Best Actress.
And to have Tom Hanks and Meryl Streep together.
Seeing them was amazing. Actually... And a lot of people said that journalists should watch it. But when I watched it, I was like, proprietors should watch it.
Yes.
How many owners will have that spunk?
Yes.
Yeah. How many?
By the way,
I don't know of a single Indian media owner who would do that.
By the way, Z, you know, booked the hall for 3 days to show it to their
employees.
employees.
I think Subhash Chandra needs to watch it more than his because it's true, you know, that scene where she says that you have nothing to lose, the editor, but you know, she has risked so much.
She had everything to lose. So that's the first one. I think please go and watch it. And the second one is, there's a, you know, we were talking about job Modi Pakoda and all that stuff, and you know, about the jobs, where are the jobs coming from. There's a fantastic debate taking place in the social media and in print, nothing much on television, about I think a working paper that came out from the someone economic advisor to the SBI and an IIM Bangalore professor. They'd authored this paper saying that jobless growth is a myth, i.e. that last year 5.5 million formal sector jobs were actually created.
Okay.
And they looked at the payrolls from the Provident Fund and all that to find out, you know, how many new enrollments are there and how many active enrollments and all that stuff. So based on their analysis, they said last year 5.5 million formal jobs were created. And now that triggered a debate. So there was a rebuttal of that by Praveen Chakrabarty and Jairam Ramesh in The Hindu, saying that all your data is absolutely rubbish and these are the points that you did not take care of it and, you know, this is simply not true. And then there was a rebuttal of that rebuttal by the original author saying that, no, your piece is rubbish. These are the things. So there's fantastic data-filled debate going on.
Okay.
And I think this is one of the last things I would say the stick to attack Modi, because the economy seems to be back on track now. Things are moving well and all that stuff, our post-demonetization. So this jobless growth business and how many jobs are being created, what you promised. So I think if this egg is cracked, I think this would be the last kind of battleground, Kurukshetra, for pro and anti-Modi forces. So I think please, so there are three articles, one in Times of India that triggered the whole thing, and then two in The Hindu. Hmm. And they possibly are going to be more. So this is an excellent debate.
Nice.
But there were also, I mean, just in that context, couple of articles in the Mint, and there are these Forbes survey, what was it? Not livability, worse off. Indians are worse off under Modi.
Yeah, yeah.
In prosperity or in
survival,
in survivability, something
like
that kind. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So, but I'm always amazed at the timing of these reports, Forbes and others. I mean, there is again in the West. And from the World Bank saying India is going to be the fastest, largest economy, fastest growing, largest economy. Somebody else in the West says, no, it's the livability or survivability is much lower than before. So I think data can be interpreted both ways. You know, as a journalist, I'm sort of supportive of you know, data crunching and data-based analysis. But sometimes it's also about perceptions. Voters really don't care, in my view, about GDP, about growth rate, as long as people have their, you know, dal roti or the daily
pakoras
and security. More than anything else, security. I think I go across the country. I was in down south in Belgaum, for instance, which is a small, medium-sized town. And I was doing a back-of-the-envelope kind of survey. And I asked them, what is it that you feel that this government has done right and wrong? So they said, right is that, you know, except for violence in Kashmir, which is so distant, and some parts of Punjab, we've been completely violence-free. And that's true. I didn't realize. I mean, despite being a security analyst and all that, I didn't really
look at it
in terms of terror attacks in the mainland, touch wood. So that is one. And second, they said, of course, the mahangai, I mean, the, you know, the inflation has gone up. That is their worry.
Mm.
But otherwise, they seem to be quite content. I mean, you know, that way the perceptions differ from state to state. If you are living in the north, there are other issues. If you go down south, there are other issues. So I think the suggestion is that keep reading, but the overload of information is going to be a challenge. How to sift through it? I feel that that's a challenge for me, but I don't know how normal people react.
We generally recommend something that we like, we've read, or, you know, so anything you want to recommend?
Your book.
your book.
You can do that. My book actually gives a lot of information and data, and as I discussed with Anand, Anand also pointed out, I have not given my opinion in many cases. And so therefore, it might seem to be laudatory, which I don't mind. I mean, in the sense that I am no longer a journalist who has to be absolutely, you know, objective, which is not possible in any case. A journalist who has to say on the one hand, on the other, I don't try to say that. This is my view. And,
you know, so the balancing act.
Yes. So that's it.
Okay. Anand, your suggestions for the week?
Now, I'm reading Shashi Tharoor's book, Why Are You My Hindu?
How is it?
So it has to be read for the reason that how it is easy for some people to get published. So once you are in a circle, the publishing industry works as a similar mafia as media is. So it's get very easy to get published. He wrote on foreign policy, Pax Indica. It was just a compilation of his newspaper articles. So these are the people who can get away with this. You compile your newspaper articles. It is a drawing room reflection on some issues.
It's people like us.
People like us kind
of
thing.
You have to work for a book.
But it has a layman's take on his religious encounters with the religion he was born in. And it has a layman's kind of value to religious exploration. But in absence of, authority over, Sanskrit or scriptures, he talks a lot of things which add no value to second-hand information.
So he was speaking in Davos something.
So that is these are the kind of people who get published by Aleph and Penguin. So you read it for how this club is doing well.
But talking about books, I must say, if you have to change your perception
the
about
laconic remarks of Anand Vardhan,
if you have to change your views on certain things, certain perceptions that are embedded in the Indian mind, please go and read Bertil Lindner's China's India War. It should serve as a eye-opener to many of our scholars who have looked at India's war in 1962 with China from one angle, that is India was
Wasn't
the one...
Wasn't Nitin?
No,
Wasn't.
That is Neville Maxwell.
Oh, okay.
So
right,
Neville
right,
Maxwell's
right,
was... India's China War.
Yes.
This is China's India War. Bertil Lindner is a Swedish journalist worked in Southeast Asia. Mm-hmm. He's based in Chiang Rai.
Okay.
Chiang Mai, in North Thailand.
Right.
And he has busted the myth that India provoked the war. And it was not China. China had prepared for this war 3 years before the war broke out.
Wow.
So it's a very well-documented research book and it should unshackle, hopefully, our researchers on China. Their mind.
Even that Himalayan blunder was
that
banned.
That was an army officer, but that was his personal perspective. But therefore, I say that, nearly, 50?
More than
55
that.
55 years now, 56 years after the war, if this book has come out, it's something that one must
and
read.
And still the Henderson Brooks report has not been out.
But that was partly taken by, Neville Maxwell was given
Part
this
one,
report.
Yeah.
This was he was given the report. He based on his based his book on that report, which was leaked to him. So leakage of confidential documents is not something new.
Ravan sir, your recommendation?
David Letterman has started his my next guest with his stint with Netflix. So his first guest was Barack Obama. So I saw that, and Obama is basically talking about his life after the post-presidency. So it's quite interesting what all he is doing and what all he's doing with his children and his wife. So interesting take. So I'll suggest one should watch this.
I'll go with Anand's recommendation. Please watch The Post. Really nice. And that's all that we have for Hafta today. Remember, pay to keep news free. When the public pays, the public is served. When corporations pay, corporates are served. And we leave you with this song.
Mere desh ki dharti sona ugle ugle hire moti. Mere desh ki dharti. Mere desh ki dharti. Mere desh ki dharti sona ugle ugle hire moti.
Have a great weekend, have a great long weekend, and see you next week on Hafta.
Happy Republic Day.
All the News Laundry podcasts are available on Stitcher, iTunes, and any other podcast platform.
Please subscribe to News Laundry. Help us keep news independent. Catch all our podcasts on news, pop culture, current affairs and sport. Visit newslaundry.com. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. And subscribe to our YouTube channel.